Good morning. My name is Jim Birchfield, senior pastor here at First Presbyterian Church, Houston, and it's my great pleasure to be the first to welcome you to our worship service today. Before we begin our broadcast, I'd like to share a few things that we hope will improve your worship experience. First, we would love to know that you are here and if there are any ways that we can serve you. During today's service, our online pastor will join you in worship and be available to respond to any messages or questions that you might want to share online. If you're joining us on Facebook, please take a moment to like the service or to say hello. If you feel there is someone who might benefit from today's message, we encourage you to share it. If you're joining us from our website, you can complete a connection card, view today's bulletin, or share a need via our live prayer button. Finally, if you're a member of the FPC community or just want to contribute to the ongoing ministry initiatives of our church, you can give online or via text by clicking our Give Online button. Friends, I understand that this is a time when we may still seem far apart from one another. Please know that in this season, you are not alone. We are reminded that Christ is with us, that Christ is for us, and that Christ loves us. Remember that He promises us His peace, a peace we can own, and a peace that transcends all understanding. Your FPC family is with you and remains here to serve you. Please enjoy our service. Good morning. I'm Jim Birchfield, and on behalf of my friend and colleague, John Krantz, we want to welcome you to our worship service this morning here at First Presbyterian Church. We simply want to say that you are welcome, that we will this Sunday celebrate the sacrament of communion, and that you have been prayed for. And our prayer is that you would have an encounter with Jesus today through the music, through the opening of God's word, through our times of prayer. We have been praying for you that you will indeed come to know God as the God who loves you and is present with you.
Let us pray. And so, God, we enter into our time of worship with gratitude, knowing that you are a God who is with us, even though we and so many of us are miles apart. You are omnipresent. You are the one that is binding us together as your people. And so as we worship you, as we sing, as we pray, as we preach, as we listen, we pray that you will help us be reminded that there truly is an audience of one, that you would be pleased not only with what you hear, but what you see in our hearts, and that we as your people would long to glorify your name, not just in these moments, but each and every day. So God, we invite you to inhabit our worship. To you and your name be the glory. Amen. Amen. Let us worship God. if you would, wherever you are, please join me as we pray. And so, God, it's with great joy, actually, that we pray and confess our sins to you. Joy knowing that you're listening and that you are a God who loves us even when we sin and stumble, and you long to forgive us. And all you require is that we ask. And so I pray that as we confess our sins to you would remind us of your grace, a grace that we often forget and we often withhold from others, but that you would be our teacher today, showing us and reminding us that you need for us to be a people who both receive and give your grace. So hear us now as we confess our sins to you confidently and boldly and honestly, knowing that you are indeed a God who is quick to forgive. Amen. These words that we speak frequently over you in our worship services come from Ephesians 2. You're actually going to hear them in a moment during Pastor Jim's sermon. But we use these words so often because they're so good. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Would you please receive this gift again today, that in Jesus, through his grace and his mercy for you, you are forgiven and being made whole. Amen and amen. The peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Wherever you find yourself, if you would extend Christ's peace to one another with your family, your friends, if you're worshiping together, if you are not, would you please text someone the peace of Christ? And let's be a people that are reminded that his peace is actually with us and for us. And because we can experience the peace of Christ and his forgiveness, it makes it all the more easier to be able to extend that peace to one another. So God bless you as we continue on in worship.
The following hymn was written especially for this particular sermon series by our own Dr. John Yerington. He drew together themes from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, and he dedicated this particular hymn to the Reverend Dr. Andrew Stepp. Bear in mind that when we say hymn, that actually refers to the text of the song that we sing. The melody that we're going to sing is named Nettleton.
As you sing with songs of praises, lift
So we come this morning to the second installment in our study in the book of Ephesians, and our text this morning is going to be Ephesians chapter 2, the first 10 verses. So let's pray. Lord, would you open this text to us this morning? Would you be the one to speak to us? Would you illumine our hearts and our minds that we might understand your word for us today? This we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Ephesians chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. We give thanks for God's good word. So, we study Paul's letters to the church in Ephesus to rediscover, or at least be reminded, of the character and the purpose of the church as it was given to us by the early church, by the apostles Paul and Peter and John and others, by the teaching of Jesus. And we wrestled with the question of why. Why do we need to do that in our day and age? And it's because the church is always changing and adapting. And as the church changes and adapts, it's easy for us to lose focus on what's important. So it's important and helpful for us then to return to the core values of Scripture, the core values in the New Testament, that we might be reminded of who we really are. Let me give you an example of that. So when I use the word church, it often connotates an image of a building, or it brings to mind ministries of the church or positions taken by the church. And we need to be reminded first and always that the church is about people. That there's more about who we are in Paul's letter to the Ephesians than about what we are called to do. That there's some amazing theology in this letter, but first and foremost, it's a letter from a pastor to the church, written to encourage people who are living in Christ and for Christ to do so in their daily lives. So why is this relevant to us today? Well, I think one of the greatest challenges that we have is living with hope in the midst of challenging and confusing times. And the times were just as challenging for the Ephesians as they are for us today, though the challenges were different. Paul was writing to encourage a group of believers who were experiencing confusion and trial in their lives as we feel we are today in ours. And as Paul addresses those challenges, he begins by reminding them of who they were before they were saved by Christ. And he reminds them of the life that they were living before they were saved by Christ, the life that they were saved from, if you will. And he also writes to remind them of the power of God to save them and to hold them and assure them of the life that will be theirs. And the point of all of this, I think the point of the first chapter and a half of Paul's letter is that just like the prayer we studied last week, the Ephesians and we today would come to know God as real. That we would come to understand what God has done, and that the power of God to give us new life is the same power that assures us of our salvation and our new life, the same power then
that assures us of a true and deep hope, even in the midst of challenging times. In the first three verses of this chapter, Paul essentially says, remember who you were before you were saved, before you were rescued, before you were reconciled to God, before you were adopted into God's family. And he paints two very vivid pictures of the human condition apart from God. The first, he says, is we are dead in our sins. And then the second, he says, we are prisoners of war. Now, he doesn't actually use either of those two terms, but let me describe the picture that he's painting. This first picture is this idea that we are dead in our sins or dead to sin. And it's a picture of humanity after the fall, right? So we'd go all the way back to the beginning of the story, to God's good creation. And one of the things that made it good was that there was a balance and a peace and a harmony between God and humankind, between humankind and God, between God and his creation, between humankind and creation, and all were living in harmony and at ease. The first humans had one job, right? They were allowed to do anything they wanted in the garden as long as they stayed away from the tree of good and evil. And the first humans chose poorly. They fell to the temptation that they could be like God. And the consequence of that, as we know, is that humankind has been separated from God, and we now live under his judgment. We were alienated not only from God, but from one another and from creation. That's when death entered into the picture. That's when disease and sin and all of the other things that make life so hard came into our world. And I want to make sure we understand something, because I think it's something that is often understood. That is the status and condition of every single person after the fall. Paul makes that point. That includes us. That includes the Ephesians before they were rescued by Christ. That is the condition and the status of every human being. Not dead because we commit sins, but dead in our sin as heirs of the consequences of the choices made by the first humans. So that's the first picture, that we are dead in our sins, apart from God, separated from God. The second picture is, Paul, again, doesn't use these words, but basically what he's describing is we were living as prisoners of war, captive or enslaved to three different powers. One, the ways of the world, one, the devil, and the third being ourselves. The ruler of the kingdom of air is what Paul uses for to name the devil in this letter. And it reminds us that the devil carries many names in Scripture. The prince of darkness, the ruler of this world, the father of lies. So Paul says the first one that we are enslaved to is the devil. The second thing that we are enslaved to is the ways of the world. And what Paul means by that is the world outside of the kingdom of God, the world separate and apart from God. The systems of this world, good, bad, and indifferent, the enmity that exists between races and cultures and classes, the conventional wisdom, what we call our culture, the incoherence of human reason, all of those things, Paul says, we are enslaved to, captive to, the ways of the world. But Paul's primary focus is on what he describes as our fallen nature, the fallen or broken human heart. He says we are living to gratify the cravings of our sinful nature. Or apart from God, we are living to gratify the cravings of our sinful nature. In other words, we're heirs to the rebellion of the first two humans. And we exhibit the very same tendencies that they did, the tendency to want to be like God, to push God away from the center of our lives and to live essentially for ourselves. And friends, this is not a new idea, by the way. This is not just something that has come up as a critique of the current culture or even recent culture. It's been around from the beginning. It's an idea that was present in Paul's letter to the Romans, where he says in chapter 7, verse 15, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do.
Augustine, writing in the year 400, coined this phrase. He said, our lives are curved inward on ourselves, right? Our nature is to serve ourselves. Martin Luther, basically continuing Augustine's idea in the 1500s, said this. He said, our nature is so deeply curved in on itself that it not only bends the best gifts of God towards itself, but it even uses God himself in order to attain these gifts and fails to realize that it seeks all things, even God, for its own sake. That's what Paul is describing as living to gratify the cravings of our sinful nature, enslaved to the notion that we live for ourselves. That's the condition of the human race apart from a Savior. We are dead to sin, enslaved to ourselves, to the influence of the devil, the lies of the devil, and the ways of the world. Now, it might be fair to ask at this point, is this really a big deal in this day and age? Why is this important? And I'll offer two reasons. The first reason it's important is that if Christianity is right, if the Bible is true, then those who are not in Christ are still dead in their sins and will remain so eternally. I think that's a big deal. There's another reason that I think it's a big deal, and that's that we will experience the effects, right, of being apart from God. We do experience those effects, that captivity and enslavement to ourselves, on a daily basis. It manifests itself in the idea that our loves are disordered, as Augustine is famous for saying, that we do have this tendency to take good things and elevate them to the ultimate things as a way of worshiping ourselves. And when we lose them then, we lose hope, we lose joy, we lose confidence, where? In ourselves. We experience it as self-absorption that makes us susceptible to the lies of the devil, the lies that tell us we're not good enough, or that our ability to succeed and flourish in life is all on us. And if we allow that lie to take root deep in our hearts, then we begin to live in such a way that we want to justify ourselves, justify our existence, make our mark on the world. We begin, as Paul says in this passage, to boast in ourselves, to boast in the confidence that we have in ourselves and in ourselves alone, and to project that boasting out onto the world, even if our lives become lies in the process. Just finished watching a really enjoyable program that's been on Netflix called Away. And it's a story of a crew that is sent from the Earth to be the first mission to Mars and how they come to land on the planet. And one of my favorite character in the first season is a Russian cosmonaut by the name of Misha. Misha is, in the story, the most famous Russian cosmonaut in the history of the Russian space program. And he's miserable. He's miserable because he is estranged from his daughter. He comes to realize that what he has done in his life, what he has done to estrange himself from his daughter, he didn't do for love of country. He didn't do out of duty and honor and a desire to be obedient to the needs of the country like he told her all the times that he had gone into space. What he comes to realize and what he comes to finally admit to himself and to her is that he did it because he wanted to be great. He wanted to be seen as great. He wanted to boast in himself. And it was only as he was willing to expose that lie to himself and to others that he began to find peace and his better nature began to emerge. Friends, I could go on and on with this. I believe that it's our separation from God that and our self-worship that gives us the sense often that our life is not working because it's not working the way we want to create it. It's what gives us that discontent with life, this sense, this yearning that there must be something more, something better. Tragically, I think it's what causes us to live in fear and anxiety. My friend Austin Herman reminded me of a great quote from G.K. Chesterton that says, if we don't fear God, we don't become fearless. We fear everything. If everything is on me, then I fear anything that challenges me. If my life, however, is grounded in God, then I receive life from God, trusting in His love for me. So yeah, I believe this is a big deal. Paul's picture of humankind apart from God is a big deal, with the consequences of our choices of our faith being felt both in the present moment and in eternity. But here's the good news. In verses 4 and 5, Paul says, but God offers us a way back to Himself, a way back to true life, the abundant life that we were created to live. He describes this process where basically he's saying that just as God raised Jesus from the dead, God's desire is to rescue us, to raise us up from spiritual death and give us life in Christ, seated with Christ forever in the heavens, reconciled to God and adopted into God's family. And all God asks of us in return in verses 8 and 9 is that we trust and believe that this is true, that we accept His gift as being from Him and not something that we have earned. Verse 6, he says that we will be seated with Jesus. Don't take that literally. We're not literally seated with Jesus at the moment, but we're treated as we are. It's a legal status, if you will. It's a promise that one day we will be able to redeem, that we have an assurance that that will be our status. And one day, literally, that will be the case. And all of this, what I want us to see is all of this links back to the prayer that Paul offered for the Ephesians that we studied last week. That they would come, that we would come to know God so deeply that we would have this deep, profound trust of God, such that our trust in God would allow us to live with real hope, because our trust now is based on an eternal assurance that not only saved us, but is at work to protect that inheritance until we die and go to be with God for eternity. Why would God do this? What's His purpose in doing this? That's what you see in verses 4 through 10. First reason is because of His great love for us. The second reason Paul mentions is because of His mercy toward us. The third reason he mentions is in verse 7, because of God's incomparable grace and kindness. And then in verse 10, the first hint that there's something larger in mind than just our own individual salvation. He's doing all of these things out of His love, out of His mercy, out of His grace and kindness, that we would, verse 10, live for Him, witness to Him, be His church, so that others might come to know Him and experience the same rescue from death to life. Ephesians 2, verses 1 through 10 is the very heart of the gospel. Death is putting ourselves in the place of God. Rescue and salvation comes as Christ takes our place and reconciles us to God. Christ takes the place that we deserve. Through faith that this is God's great gift, we are lifted up to new life. We are seated with Him forever. John Stott says that the essence of sin is us substituting ourselves for God. And the very heart of the gospel is Christ substituting Himself for us, that we would be reunited with God. And in that transaction, right, not only are we declared alive and seated with God in the heavenlies, but we are also set free from the captivity of living for ourselves and free for living for Christ and for others. Tim Keller puts it this way. He says, we're set free from a life where we feel like everything depends on us, and given the freedom to live a life where everything comes to us as a gift
from a God who loves us. I would put it this way. We're set free from the anxiety of the life that we are trying to build, the life that we are trying to achieve, and we are allowed to live at peace with the life that God wants us to receive. A life that is grounded not in a hope in myself, but in a hope in God's love. And again, all it takes for us to achieve this life, as I come to close, is the faith to receive it as God's good gift, to believe, but more than that, to trust, to rest upon that which I trust that I would receive God's peace. Friends, and I believe that that is the beginning of the abundant life, the truly flourishing life that we all seek so desperately, the life that allows us to live with a deep hope, even in confusing and challenging and hard times. In Jesus' name and for his sake, amen. I invite you now to spend a few moments with me as we pray. Let us pray. And so, God, we respond to your word that we have heard preached and tell you thank you. Thank you that you are a God who is not silent, but we can listen to you through your word and through this act of preaching that we have just received. I pray that you would continue to remind us of your grace each and every day. That is something that we could never do to earn, but we simply just receive it. And as we receive it, we recognize that you use it to transform us to become like Jesus. And so help us to be a people who both receive and give out your grace. We continue to pray for our entire congregation during this season of COVID. We especially think of our children and our youth in our church, who many are going back to school, that you would protect them, be with their families and parents as we experience and long to experience a bit more normal time. We pray for those who are sick and in the hospital, for those who are unable to be with them, that you would, you yourself would be with them and remind them that you're very near. We pray for those who have lost loved ones, that they are waiting to have a memorial or they already have had one. In so many ways, God, the grief is that much more during this season, and we pray that you would intervene. And for all the ways in which we need you, God, we cry out and say, Lord Jesus, please come into our life, into our circumstance, that we would not forget you after this worship service is over, but that each and every day during this week and beyond, we would long to make you a part of our lives. So thank you, God, for what you have done in us. And we pray that you would continue to do what only it is that you can do, intervene and bless and remind us of who you are. So all this we pray in the name of Jesus, our Savior, the Lord, who taught us all to pray together saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As we enter into a time of communion, we invite you to go locate some bread and liquid juice, if you can, to celebrate communion in your home. I want to remind you of something that is profoundly helpful when we think of communion out everywhere in the different homes in our community. That while we're apart and we can't be together, we can know that God is actually with us. God is omnipresent. He's actually present in every single home for people who are watching today. And so may that give us hope and peace, knowing that He is the one that is binding us together as His people, as we enjoy this sacrament together. And so we remember on the night Jesus was betrayed, He took bread and He broke it, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And after supper, He took the cup and He said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it, all of you." And so, friends, as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until He comes again. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Enjoy it together. Let's continue now to worship the Lord.
Before we have our benediction, let me invite you to stay over after the service for a couple of seconds and allow the announcements, some things that are going on in the life of our congregation, to scroll up and let you in on what's going on. Secondly, I want to invite you to stay and chat with our online pastor and our online community for a bit, and even join us in our Zoom chat, our virtual campus, following the service, where you have an opportunity to perhaps meet some other people, to ask some questions, to share your reflections on what you heard God saying to you today. So we invite you to come and be a part of that. And now, my brothers and sisters in Christ, may we truly live this day, knowing the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the friendship, the presence, and the partnership of the Holy Spirit, today, tomorrow, and forever. Amen.
Thank you.